I'm going to call on Dr. Mark Everett to come and introduce our guest speaker.
You'll have to move that back up again, Sheldon. Thank you, Glenn. OCMs, Yaya, Kwasai, Eddie, our elder gardener. Thank you, Elder Gardner, for that welcome to the traditional territory of the Stalo people. Well, let me begin by saying a few words about this lecture series. I established the President's Leadership Lecture Series as one of the ways to further the goals of the university, and those who've heard me speak know that I'm pretty shameless about promoting those goals, providing the best undergraduate education in Canada, and equally as important, being a leader of the development of the Fraser Valley, the social, the cultural, the economic, and the environmentally responsible development of the Fraser Valley. And I created this series to bring inspirational leaders to the university and to our valley whose work is directly relevant to the issues we face in our region and at our university. Leaders who we know will share their ideas, challenge us, and we know even provoke us a little bit. Well, without doubt, today's speaker will do all of that. Sheldon Kennedy is returning to the University of the Fraser Valley. We're proud to say he's returning this time as an alumnus of our university, because many of you will be aware that last spring we awarded Sheldon, in recognition of his many achievements, with an honorary doctorate. So we're very proud. Now, it's appropriate that Sheldon's return visit should be on this particular day, what's come to be called Pink Shirt Day, when we wear this color as a reminder of the importance of empowering people, young and old, to stand up to bullies, and to remind all of us of our responsibility to act when we see bullying and abuse. We're delighted that Sheldon's with us on this special day, because this man personifies that message. As a boy and a young man, he suffered terrible sexual abuse and bullying by his coach at a time when so many people were in denial about such things happening in sport. But with remarkable courage and a recognition that he needed to speak out, not only for himself, but for the many others who couldn't or wouldn't, he stood up to his abuser. And at great personal cost, he stood up not only to that abuser, Graham James, but he stood up to a culture of denial and to the many people who really wanted all of that to go away. Not only did he win his case, he empowered others to stand up too. That, dear friends, is true leadership. Mr. Kennedy left his career in hockey to devote his life to fighting abuse and to promoting awareness, prevention, and intervention. His life story was made into an award-winning television movie. He's frequently invited as an expert consultant and commentator, appearing on Oprah, Nightline, W5, The Fifth Estate, and many other shows. He served as an expert witness to Canadian parliamentary committees and the U.S. Congress, and many of you may have heard Sheldon's testimony before the U.S. Senate hearing on the Penn State case involving the assistant football coach. And of course, he's a frequent guest on Canadian news broadcasts. Sheldon, many times at dinner, as I eat my meal, I hear you speak about this extraordinarily important cause. He's been a very active fundraiser for this important cause, and with business partner Wayne McNeil, who's also with us here today, Wayne and Sheldon established Respect Incorporated, a company devoted to education for the prevention of abuse, bullying, and harassment, and a service that reaches many thousands of people a year with messages, and most importantly, the tools of empowerment. And today, he brings that message of responsibility and empowerment to us here at the University of the Fraser Valley. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said at convocation last spring, and what also turned out to be Sheldon's birthday, apologize for hijacking the band for a little happy birthday tune.
knows I don't really apologize.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Sheldon Kennedy.
Sheldon Kennedy was born on June 15th, 1969 in Brandon, Manitoba. In 1988, he played for Canada at the World Junior Hockey Championships, bringing home the gold medal. The following year, as captain of the Swift Current Broncos, he led the team to a Memorial Cup win. During his 8 years with the NHL, he skated for the Detroit Red Wings, Calgary Flames, and the Boston Bruins. In addition to his stellar hockey career, Sheldon Kennedy is also known for the courageous decision to charge his junior hockey coach with sexual assault for abuse he suffered over a 5-year period when he was a teenager under his care. Sheldon's decision to go public with the charges brought the issue of child sexual abuse to the social forefront. He has since become an unofficial spokesperson for millions of survivors around the world. In 1998, Sheldon strapped on inline skates on a cross-Canada tour, raising more than $1 million for sexual abuse programs operated by the Canadian Red Cross. His life story was then made into an award-winning television movie called The Sheldon Kennedy Story. Sheldon has appeared on Oprah, ABC's Nightline, and The Fifth Estate. In 2006, he wrote a book called Why I Didn't Say Anything, a riveting account of the psychological impact of the abuse he suffered. In 2004, Sheldon and his business partner, Wayne McNeil, along with the Canadian Red Cross, co-founded Respect Group Inc. Together, they launched an online training program called Respect in Sport. The program focuses on educating adult youth leaders on abuse, bullying, and harassment prevention, as well as the legal and moral responsibilities when working with youth. During the 7 years that the Respect in Sport program has existed, many sport and youth organizations have mandated the program, including Hockey Canada, Gymnastics Canada, USA Triathlon, US Rowing, and an early adopter, the province of Manitoba. In 2004, the idea of an online certification for coaches and adults who train young people was a difficult sell. But when Manitoba adopted the Respect in Sport program as mandatory, it paved the way for many other organizations to adopt the program, with now more than 250,000 adults trained nationwide. The program's success furthered Sheldon's reputation as an expert on the issue. In the aftermath of the Penn State sexual abuse case, Sheldon was asked to testify before the U.S. Congressional Subcommittee on Children and Families. For his initial bravery and continued commitment to this very important cause, Sheldon received an honorary doctorate of laws from the University of the Fraser Valley in June of this year. By his courageous actions, he has made it easier for Canadians to talk about this difficult subject, particularly men who were sexually abused as children. Through this dialogue, he has also changed the face of Canadian amateur sport forever.
Well, thanks for having me. Thanks, Mark, for having me back here and doing a... did you get a copy of that video before you wrote your speech? Or? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. And Eddie, thank you, Eddie. That was great. Yes. I always love the drums. And, you know, I don't make a career out of speaking. So I think hopefully here today we'll try to create a conversation. I'm going to speak and kind of give you a little background of where we started and where we are today. And then we'll get into some questions and answers and so forth. It's, I find that... you know, me preaching in front of people isn't always the best, and especially when it comes to these issues, I think it's about creating conversation and keeping it simple. So, you know, for me, it's how did I get into this? Well, I can tell you that I didn't have my lunch kit walking down to the end of the lane thinking this is what I was going to do for a living, I can tell you that. You know, but I think sometimes you find yourself in a situation, in a position where sink or swim. And I was in a position where, you know, I felt that for so many years I felt that I was alone with what was going on. And the reality was is that I wasn't. Because when the story broke and Graham James was charged 16 years ago, I had hundreds of thousands of letters coming in. And And I'm not kidding you. There were stacks of them of people telling their stories. So I felt that start to carrying the message, just trying to push for change around issues where the doors weren't easily opened. And, you know, I think that we talk about today the difficulty of the type of conversation that we want to have around abuse, bullying, harassment, all of the social issues that we deal with that I think are all affect the same. But talking about them back then was pretty difficult. And I think that we were able to get doors open and people were starting to let us in and they wanted to have the conversation about this. And, you know, we weren't perfect coming out of the gate, right? We came out, we thought, okay, well, what do we need to be doing here? Well, we need to educate, right? I think when we don't understand stuff or we're a little bit scared of stuff, you know, we need to educate ourselves. And I think that some of the programs, I sat on the board with Hockey Canada, the Speak Out program, and when we first started the education process was about, okay, well, let's try to catch the bad guy. And the reality is that the odds of doing that's like finding a needle in the haystack. So we did that for a while, and the revelation that we had after reaching so many people was that we needed to empower the bystander. Why focus on 2% of the people when we can focus on 98% of the people and give them the tools to be better and understand these types of issues? So that's what we started to do, but that came about 9 years down the pipe. When we rollerbladed across the country, we did raise over $1 million, and we donated that to the Red Cross. And the Red Cross actually just got recognized by their organization and the Red Crescent movement worldwide to be the experts within their organization to provide this type of education in refugee camps around the world and so forth. So we feel pretty proud about that. It's been interesting because, you know, I don't consider myself an expert in this field. I mean, I think that I've been around long enough and I've been pounding the pavement and I've been in the trenches long enough that I understand. I understand the issues. I try to look at how my situation and other situations could have been prevented. And when I look at my situation in Swift Current, and I was actually just back there on Family Day weekend, there was an event going on that I went back for, and you know, you see that the damage that an individual like a Graham James has on that whole town. Because when he's operating, there's a lot of people that had a gut feeling that something wasn't right and didn't have the courage or the knowledge to ask the questions or do anything about it. And is it that they're bad people? Absolutely not. I think that the reality is they didn't have the tools to know what to do or didn't understand what they could do or what they had to do. But I see, you know, that town and the shame and the guilt that is left for the thousands of people that are in that town that were involved in the game. And so when I was asked to go down and talk at Penn State, what was our message? Well, our message was really about empower the bystander, because I look at Penn State and the way I saw it and what came out of that, and, you know, here's the janitor talking about, oh, well, I thought something was wrong, and here's somebody else, well, I thought something was wrong, and, oh, geez, this was brought to us, and you guys didn't do anything about it, but, you know. And so the whole goal was to empower the bystander. Give the janitor the education and the knowledge to act on his gut. Give him the confidence around these issues to act and to ask the questions. And I don't think it's about being rocket science here. It's about creating confidence around some difficult issues. And when I talk about that, I think it's about keeping it simple. You know, I think these issues are confusing enough as it is. So when I talk about these issues, it's about keeping them simple, keeping it street level language, this stuff. I think a lot of the times, a lot of the education, a lot of the pieces that are out around this stuff, you know, I'm trying to understand when I first started looking at it, and we were a lot better today than where we were. When I first started looking at it, I didn't understand the $26 words that they had laying down in front of me. So for me, I personally had to dummy it up and let's just create a simple language around this stuff and break down abuse, break down a bullying and so forth. And it's all really about imbalance of power. You know, and if we look at what we have as an educator or as a volunteer coach, as a parent, as a big brother, a big sister, we've got the opportunity to really shape the lives of young people that are in our care, whether we believe that or not. And our intentions could be, oh, I'm just going to take a bag of balls out and be a volunteer coach. But the reality is that, you know what, we may be the only trusted adult in some of these kids' lives. So we better make sure we have the tools to know how to handle that if a kid discloses to us. Not that you're a bad coach or not that you're a bad person and we're looking out for you. It's about, you know what, we're in a situation that, and especially in today's day and age, where we may be, like I said, the only trusted adult in these kids' lives. And we better know how to handle it if they, you know, confide in us, stuff that's going on at home, you know, in a classroom or something that's happened in their life. And I think that to me is about empowering the bystander. I think it's all of our responsibility. And I don't think that there's anything wrong with asking questions. Geez, I saw something just, you know. Well, go ask about it. Why don't we ask our organizations? What do you have in place around this stuff? I don't think there's anything wrong with that. And I think that that's what we're trying to do. And, you know, I'm about action and getting stuff done. I like to make sure we get stuff done but I think that, you know, it was really, I don't know what it was, 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago anyway, we're announcing with the federal government about, you know, making an announcement. They're talking about tough on crimes and pedophiles and extending longer sentences and that sort of stuff. And longer sentences are a feel good. That's an easy one. Stick them away for life, right? That's a feel good. But the reality is I think that where our focus needs to be is, really reaching the victims of the type of crime early. And that early intervention, because the reality is that, you know what, like, for every pedophile we might catch two. Right? So we need to be able to really focus and give kids an outlet and really focus on turning kids' lives around and giving them another opportunity to come forward so that they don't end up in our prison systems, our healthcare systems, and so forth, because that's what happens. That's where they end up. And so anyway, we were at this announcement, and to be able to have that type of language at the table and having not only the Prime Minister talking about it, but also the Federal Justice Minister talking about early intervention and prevention and the Victims' Bill of Rights. And to be able to, and then talking about child advocacy centers is huge, because we never heard that before, right? We never heard that. It was all tough on crime and get them, stick them away. And so to be able to have that language, I think, is huge. And to be able to shape what that looks like is huge. And to be able to understand, because I think when we talk about these issues, like, I think it's, you know, sometimes it's a little bit easier when somebody, you know, is maybe has got two broken legs and they walk into a room and it's, oh, geez, you're really hurting, you know. And I think that sometimes, and I think that most cases, it's a lot more difficult when you're looking at the bullying, the sexual assaults, and the damage that it leaves in your wake. We can't physically see it in a lot of cases. And I think it's hard for people to get their head around. So to me, it's about we're dealing with an invisible trauma. We're dealing with an invisible damage until it's too late, until we're reading about the statistics that a kid's dead. So to me, it's about trying to paint the picture of the type of damage that this type of crime has, whether it be bullying, sexual assault, domestic violence, whatever it might be. Trying to be able to paint that picture so people can understand. And I think that, you know, when we look at that and we look at the victims of those types of crimes and where they're ending up in our systems, you know, and sometimes people react a lot different to dollar signs than they do anything else. But, you know, we're spending hundreds of billions of dollars a year on victims of crime going and entering our systems. And that's a reality. So why wouldn't we be trying to put a little bit more on the front end? So that's kind of what I try to do today is try to break systems down and get them working together. you know, one of the things that I'm fairly proud of and that we talk about and is child advocacy centers. And I think for the first time that what we've created in Calgary, we actually just opened on Monday, but it's the first time we've got Child and Family Services, Alberta Health, Crown Prosecutor's Office, and the police all working together under one roof. They've all got signed working memorandums of understanding so that when a kid comes in the door, there's one interview. That's it. And then more importantly, we can start working with that child and their families to start turning their lives around and giving them that opportunity, because I think that sometimes just navigating the system's a gong show in my mind. And you know, but to be able to get these agencies working together was huge. We spent 2 years doing that, you know, and get the egos out of the way and this is and that's, and be able to get them to understand that, but being able to paint the picture. And I think that, you know what, being and dealing with these issues, and nobody understands that better than the social workers, we had to deal with these issues in the furnace room because that's where the issues were, right? We had to deal with this, and anybody that worked in that field worked in the furnace room, and we'll just keep that down here. Well, we are right beside Children's Hospital. We have as big a presence as Ronald McDonald House on the campus, and they're out of the furnace room, and that's exciting. And I think that the issues are being discussed at a high level. And is everything rosy and grand and great? Absolutely not. But I think that, you know what, we've come from the furnace room to join the party. I've probably joined too many parties in my day, but not anymore though, Mark. You know, it's pretty exciting, and I think that, you know, and more is going to come out of it. And I mean, you know, we can sit and say, oh, this isn't. But you know what? When I look at the type of conversation we were having 16 years ago to the type of conversations that we're having today, the bar has moved dramatically. And it's all of us. It's not just the Sheldon Kennedy Show. I can guarantee you that. It's all of us. It's all of us working in the trenches, and I don't have any more respect for anybody that other than the people, you know, like, I have so much respect for the people that work on the front lines of this stuff, the police officers that do the investigation, the child and family services individuals, you know, the people that actually deal with this type of crime on a daily basis. That's tough work. That's really tough work. And, you know, and what's my role? And I think we all have different roles. Well, what's my role? My role is to keep it in the forefront and center for change to happen, keep pushing for change. You know, keep the ship going in the right direction, and that's what I try to do. And you know, I sit on a board, International Olympic Committee, the medical committee, and you know, it's funny because now I can fit in, Mark. Because before I'd go around the table, everybody was going around the table, and there was, you know, and we were in Zurich, and there was like this big wooden table, and you know, all these people, right? And I'm right off the farm. And and there's like, they're going around the table and they're like, oh yeah, doctor, doctor, doctor. And I'm thinking to myself, right, after 27 people, I'm like, what am I gonna say when they come get to me? And now I can say doctor. Hey, Mark? That's good. Yeah. So that's kind of funny. I just thought of that, actually. Wonder when their next meeting is. So, you know, the point of that is that we don't need 8 feet of paper to deal with these issues. What did I bring around the table? Because I have to keep it that way, is I had to keep it simple. It's like, I don't understand this. So if we're going to try to empower the bystanders, how are we going to educate all these people when we don't even know what we're talking about around the table? So the whole goal, I think, with these issues and what I've learned over the years is that simpler the better. And I know that sometimes it's hard to get our heads around that stuff, but I think that, you know, we had an individual talk to us. He says, oh, geez, Sheldon, you know, you guys just educate on common sense. And then I said, well, you know, maybe it's good sense, but we need to educate everybody so we can make it common again. And that's pretty much what we're trying to do, and really trying to create a confidence around these issues in a common language so that when we go into an organization or we go into a facility or whatever, there's standards around this stuff. You know, I think if we're working with a sport organization, and when we educate and we say mandatory education, that means every adult has to take the program. So that, you know, what happens is that for years we put posters and buttons up. That's, you know, stop bullying, speak out, all that stuff, right? Well, Johnny or Julie not making the AAA team or the soccer team or the swim team or getting an A+ on an exam, that's not abuse. But we seem to, there's a lot of times that word gets thrown out a lot. You're abusing my kid because they didn't make this or they didn't make that. So, you know, I think the goal here is we need to be clear so that a conversation can happen within an organization. You know, I think there's a huge gray area when everybody's not on the same page. And it's like, you know, you show up at a golf course, and if you want to play in a lot of golf courses, you got to have a collar shirt and certain length shorts. Well, you want to be a part of our organization? You need to take this program and get on the same page. And you know what? When we talk social change, it takes time. It's not going to change overnight, but it does take time. And that's what we try to do, is just really give organizations the opportunity to create a standard around these issues and an understanding. So now I think Glenn had a bunch of questions, and well, maybe you didn't, but there was people that had some questions and stuff. And I think that's what I'd like to do, is just get into questions, and then we can just, I'll try to answer them the best I can. Like I said, I'm not an expert, you know, and it's probably public knowledge. I mean, I attend AA meetings, so I was telling Mark that my next book's going to be From Grade 10 to Doctor, 12 Easy Steps. yeah, hey.
Well, I think you said at the beginning, Sheldon, let's create a conversation. So that's what we want to do now, is invite you into the conversation. So we have a couple of microphones, and you came with a question, maybe a comment. I'm going to bring around a microphone to you. I may need a buddy to help me. Okay, because we have two microphones. And so if you have a question and you're ready, please put up your hand, and we'll go around and we'll ask the questions and create the dialogue, Sheldon, okay?
Sure, yeah. No math questions.
What was the impetus that made you finally decide to speak out about your abuse?
Okay, so I won't repeat the question, but for me, I was playing with Calgary Flames at the time, and my wife was pregnant with our daughter, and I kept seeing Graham James outside our locker room because he was coaching the Calgary Hitmen at the time. So, there was always these young guys hanging around him. So I thought, well, if nobody else is going to do anything, then I need to do something here. And I couldn't handle that. And I knew that if I didn't do something, that I wouldn't be the dad or the person that I wanted to be. So, and my lifestyle was not good at the time. You know, I was running away from all the pain and that, and I had to do something or I probably wouldn't be around. So, but that was the catalyst of all of that. I actually had a decent experience. I went and told a detective and told my story at a, you know, being in the, there was already hints of stuff going on. So, we were in a very discreet house, and I told him my story. And you know, and I think the key with that is that, and one of the myths is there, well, just tell your story and it's all good. Well, I think that that's when individuals become the most vulnerable, is when they tell their story. It's not just tell your story and it's over. Like, I think we've learned to live a certain way with the trauma that was inflicted on us as a kid. And, there's research out there now that shows that your brain gets rewired and you live a certain way. Well, it ain't going to change overnight. You know, so when you tell your story, I think that that's when people become the most vulnerable out of this whole thing, because they start thinking, well, geez, I shouldn't have said anything. And, you know, why did I say something? And, right? And you take all these feelings are coming outside of the treasure box that you kept all your secrets in. They're coming out upside down, sideways, and everything else. And all you want to do is shove them back in there, but you can't get the lid closed. So now you got to deal with this stuff. So that is something that I really like to stress, is that, you know, telling your story is just the beginning. And I think, but it's an important beginning, but I think it's the beginning of really trying to get your power back and your life back. It's not the end.
So we have a couple more questions going here.
Hi, Sheldon. I work with kids. I work in a school, and I also work for an organization out in Chilliwack. And too often I hear of kids being too afraid to tell. I guess my question is, did that happen with you? Did you have that fear? And if so, like, what did you do to overcome that, to be able to actually come out and tell somebody?
Yeah, fear, I think, is very normal. I absolutely was scared. That's why I couldn't come out for a lot of years. And, you know, who's going to believe me, right? And a lot of times we think it's our fault. And we must have done something to deserve it. And, geez, you know, this person is, this person's a family member or a very good friend, or he's like their coach. Or so a lot of times it's really difficult because there's that tie that is... a tough one. I find it is sometimes a little bit different and more difficult than, you know, somebody coming jumping out of a bush. There's that peace, there's that trust, betrayal of trust that's huge, that people can't... and that's that grooming process. We spent a lot of time in the Graham James appeal case talking about that grooming piece. Where the judges, you know, the way he scouted, and, you know, he was trying to talk about, well, that was normal, the way hockey coaches scouted young players, and it was not normal. But it's a tough picture to paint because, you know, they put themselves and they portray themselves as the stellar a lot of times of the community in Graham James's case, right? So, you know, I mean, Graham had, you know, because there was players under the years, ages of 18, oh, we're going to have milk as a sponsor. Oh, yay, Graham, right? Right, because little Johnny, 16, coming to play on the team, right? So there's lots of that in, and it's not just the individual, like I said, like in Swift Current. So I think that there, the fear is that the individual is isolated while everybody else around is manipulated as well. So the fear of coming forward is just magnified hugely. And, and I think that is, for in my situation and my understanding is huge because, you know, and that's why I think that we have to get on. And a lot of times they come forward and they don't believe them, right? It's their fault. We start blaming the, you know, well, whatever are you doing to deserve that, right? And then they get shunned. So anyway, that's hopefully that answered some of that.
Yeah, and if I recall right, Sheldon, the first abuse account, you were 13.
It was at gunpoint, right? So, but I mean, from that time on, you're pretty much hooped, right? And when I wrote the book, it was about, you know, like, well, why didn't I say anything? And I tried to answer that question because I think that's the biggest question that is asked around these issues. It's, you know, two people reading the newspaper at Tim Hortons. Well, geez, why wouldn't he say something earlier? Right? Or, you know, it's a loved one looking at you saying, geez, well, why couldn't you tell me? You know? And then it's the biggest question that I ask myself. You know, why can't I tell somebody? What's going on? Why did I wait so long?
So we have at least three questions. So bring up your...
Hi, Sheldon. It's Kim. We met earlier. I'm part of the Pink Shirt campaign. Thank you for coming. I'm really pleased to hear about the child advocacy centers in Calgary, and you mentioned that there are multi facets that work with that. The part that I'm curious about is the importance of telling your story and being able to tell that in a restorative way. So there's the part where you tell your story to perhaps the investigator, and there's also power that comes in being able to tell your story where it's appropriate to the perpetrator. And most of my work's in the area of harassment, human rights. And I have seen the most success in dealing with restorative practices where people get to voice the impact of what has happened to them to the person who has been the respondent or the person who has been the perpetrator of whatever it has been. And typically, it's not sexual abuse, you know, 99.9% of the time. It's around workplace issues. It's those power issues. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are around the restorative practice.
Well, I'm all about restorative stuff because, you know, I mean, my whole goal is about getting out of being a victim. I don't think when you tell your story, you're automatically not a victim. I think for me, it's taken a lot of hard work and it's taken a lot of conversation. And I've never had the opportunity to sit in front of Graham James, but I can tell you that I was a lot different sitting in front of Graham James when I charged him than when this last time. You know, I was still full of shame and guilt and hung my head, and you know, I wasn't in a good place when he was sentenced in my case. But I can tell you that this last time, I wasn't the one hanging my head. But it's, and I think it's important. I mean, and that's what I think. Like a lot of times, these issues, it's about conversation. Right? And it's about understanding. And I think sometimes the individual that's, you know, if it's a workplace bullying or workplace harassment cases, I think that a lot of times the individuals have never learned differently. And I, you know, and I think, you know, and then there's pedophilia. That's on another scale, right? So if you're talking about workplace bullying and harassment and so forth, I think it's hugely important because I think that a lot of times people don't even know they're doing it. And have never learned differently in a lot of cases, and have never been challenged, and have never heard somebody else's voice. But, I mean, for me, it's about, see, because I think for me, like, yeah, I had to deal with the abuse that happened to me, but then I had to deal with the way I lived my life and the people I hurt in my path because of the way that I lived of what happened to me. And that's about owning it, right? So I had to, you know, make some amends too. It wasn't all just, I can't put my whole life and everything that I did, you know, on Graham James. I had to take some ownership on some stuff as well. So I mean, to me, what I hear is it's about having a mediator mediating a conversation and coming to a resolution. So I think that is powerful.
So we have four questions, a gentleman over here, and this gentleman, and a lady over here, and then another question back here. So we'll move around to these four questions. So please, sir.
Sheldon, you mentioned in your opening the 98%. Prior to the focus on that, it was on the 2%. What did that consist of? You said tracking down the bad guy or something. So what were you attempting to do there?
Well, I think that when we first started this type of prevention education, we thought that we had to catch the bad person within organizations, right? So we'd try to educate people and have everybody, you know, be just like catching the bad guy, right? So instead of giving them empowerment tools to be better themselves, our focus was we got to find the bad person within the organization. So the type of education that we did, it almost felt like it was, you know, everybody up against the wall and we're going to find you within an organization. So it was threatening. And when, especially back in the day when we're dealing with issues that were difficult, it was almost more threatening to go in with an organization and an education piece around that stuff. So I think what we've tried to do is go at an approach where, you know, we're dealing with good people that want to do the right thing, but need to have the tools to understand and to recognize and to deal with these issues appropriately. So it's all about language. I think the language is a lot different in 1998 than what we're dealing with today around these issues and how we shape that and how we educate and the understanding and as far as an organization and so forth is just a lot different. So when we talk about focusing on the 2%, I think that was the type of education that we put out there was we're going to have people try to like focus down on the 2% to try to, instead of saying, you know what, let's give these people the tools to recognize that, you know, because we're a good coach, good youth leader, good teacher, here's tools to be better. And because you're in this position, you know what, you may be the only trusted adult in these kids' lives. And that was a lot different than the way we were educating back in 98.
So we'll come here to this gentleman in the front, and then over to a lady over here in the middle after this gentleman.
Yeah, I really appreciate what you're doing, and I think because of you, we are light years ahead of where we were before you began this. I do have one question. Looking at the media, the radio, television, newspapers, you would think from the ads that we see that the homosexual is always the victim. The fact is the homosexual is often the perpetrator, and we never see that. I have yet to see one ad that suggests that. What do you think?
Well, this is sexual abuse, in my mind, is not about being is not about homosexuality at all. I think that if you're a perpetrator and you're a pedophile, you're a pedophile. And I mean, I've got friends of mine that are gay, and you know, it's, and they have no interest in young boys. You know, I look at Graham James. I mean, it wasn't, he was not, you know, Graham James liked young boys, period. It's Graham James. I mean, you know, he could say that he was gay and he was this, but it wasn't about that. You know, he was a perpetrator and a pedophile, and you know, and I mean, that's, I don't know if it can be any more clear than that, but that's my thoughts on that, is that it's not, it's got nothing to do with that.
Okay, thank you. We've got a microphone in here, and then lady here, and then we're going back to a gentleman way at the back here.
Sheldon, thank you very much. I was spoke to you briefly in the library, but I'm really interested in your Victims' Bill of Rights and the Child Advocacy Centers. I was exposed to this issue in the mid to late 80s, and I can tell you, if it was 90s, 80s, it was a lot different back then. But what I do know from doing a bunch of research is that there's a huge issue around what we call recovery and rehabilitation and what happens with victims that have been abused and what happens with the abusers. My understanding is there is the rate of recidivism for pedophilias is plus 90%. So when we're talking restorative justice, you know, it's like dealing with 2%. I wouldn't even, you know, waste my time with that. So looking for, and most of pedophiles operate where they have 70 to 700 victims. So trying to find them, they obviously are very sneaky, they're very manipulative, they hide in the corners. So I agree, educating the 98%. So where do we, you know, yes, educate. Do we start with the families, with the sports organizations? As an individual, where do we start with this in, you know, to make it so that the light shines? My reaction to this whole issue was to start, you said that it changes the way your brain operates. I started in the 80s to look at this, and that's my area of expertise now is brain re-education, because I actually know that what happens is it changes your genetic coding. It actually changes the way your DNA encodes, how you think, the pictures in your brain, how the information crosses the midline in your brain, and it changes everything. So unless we get to these kids early, and it isn't just a one-up, it's a long-time therapy that these kids need. You know, often they don't have the supports. And often when they're taken out of a home where maybe abuse is happening and put in into a foster care or a group home situation, there is no mandatory counseling for them then. They're housed and given food, and so it continues. So we need a lot more intervention. We need a lot more care for these kids right up front. Obviously, if they've come to an adult, there's a situation, or they've been taken out of a home, there's a problem. But we have the difference between accountability and responsibility, and who has the accountability for that? Who has the responsibility for that? You know.
Yeah, well, I know there's it's called CART, and it's in Calgary, and it's all about early intervention, and it's a police and a social worker. So it's all about early intervention in a situation, going into a home, before it happens, before it gets to the court case. So, you know, it's not about just automatic, you know, we're going in to do an interview. It's all about early intervention and prevention. And I mean, you know what? I understand rehabilitation as well as anybody. Yeah. And, you know, when I think that the reality is that, you know, I think it's perpetrators and pedophiles operate on our ignorance and indifference within our communities. That's how they operate. So why wouldn't we educate ourselves? And it's not like, oh, that person sure needs it. right? And that's about creating the standard. I mean, you know, we're all expected to do the right thing. We all think it's a heinous crime. But meanwhile, if we walk up and down the streets in Abbotsford or, you know, Calgary or Vancouver or whatever, we ask people, hey, give me the definition of abuse, bullying, and harassment, your legal moral responsibilities around doing that. What do you think the odds are of getting the right answer? Not very good. Why wouldn't we educate ourselves, right? I mean, most of the time, like, you know, most of the time, when an adult wants to spend an extraordinary amount of time with a young person, that's a flag, right? And we need to ask questions, period. I mean, you know, so I think, to me, it's about education. I mean, you know, they ask me, I have a daughter, and she's 17, and people say to me all the time, they say, oh, geez, you must be paranoid, Sheldon. Well, I'm not paranoid, right? Because you know what? I know that I've had a conversation with Ryan, and I'm not, like, I don't preach it to her, but you know what? It's the door is open, right? She knows the deal, and you know what? And she knows that we can chat about it, and she doesn't have to be perfect on the way that she asks or, you know, or brings or comes to me, but I think that that's important, right? But I think more importantly is I need to act, right? And I think that, and so I think that all we have to do here is not all we have to do. God, there's lots of stuff to do. But I think when we talk about empowerment, it's about giving people the confidence to act, right? There's one thing about talking, but to act, it's like if something seems suspicious, ask the question, right? And a lot of times we can nip that in the bud. And I don't think we're ever going to stop abuse, ever. But I think we can nip it in the bud before it becomes a 10-year long ordeal.
So is your program available online? Can people go on and find it?
We educate in the workplace, so it's adult stuff, and then we focus on the adults. We focus because, I mean, if we look at a lot of the education that's been around, it's all focused on the kid. Make sure you tell, everybody tell, I'm telling, right? And but they're telling, and a lot of times us in the adult world, we've never had the education either. So we're not really sure what they're telling us. So our goal is on the adults. So
we've got three questions.
Oh, okay, yeah, sorry. I tend to talk a lot.
We're at our time, so let's go with those three questions, and then we'll decide, are we going to go longer, or are we drawing to a close? So question one here, question back over here, and one over here. So
okay.
I was just wondering, because I've dealt with abuse before in my own life, and I find often... Oh, no. Now I'm going to cry. Okay. I find often that, like, I feel like I'm hyper-aware of when people are talking to me, and I analyze every single thing, mostly men, that they're saying. And it was worse, but, like, now I am engaged, so it's not as much because I'm not trying to find a relationship or something like that. But I find that even when I'm working, the customers that I deal with, I'm often really... reserved because I feel like they are trying to do the whole grooming thing in the way that they are acting. And I was just wondering if you ever found that difficult, feeling like everybody was a perpetrator kind of thing and always kind of on your guard and didn't allow you to, because I find myself in a situation, it doesn't allow me to either get close to people, and also I feel like in situations I should say something, I don't, because I'm worried I can't say something about everybody, but then I feel like I'm unsure about when to or when not to.
Well, I think, you know, I mean, to me, you know, I had trust issues, right? So that's what happens, and it's pretty normal. So, and when I don't trust people, my guards are up and the antennas are up, and I could read somebody within 20 feet of me. So I think part of the healing process for me was taking the risk to trust again. And that's part of the healing process. That's probably part of that invisible damage, I think, that happens. But for me to move forward, I need to take risks that I was guarded about before. And I think that that's what I hear is just trust. And trust is huge, right, in a lot of things in life. And something that I need to, you know, pay attention to on a daily basis and not shut down and just keep, you know, make sure I stay aware. And I think once I've learned to understand and keep the antennas up in a healthy way, it's not a bad thing. So... But I think it's all trust stuff, right? Like, to me, I mean, you know, I didn't let anybody get too close to me, right? So a little bit of a detachment stuff, I'd keep them out there, and then I'd never get hurt again, right? So
At the back here, we have a question.
You mentioned how the language has changed. How do you think that social media plays a part in these issues, whether it's become a bit of a double-edged sword or not?
Well, yeah, absolutely, Ayn. We were chatting about that, the double-edged sword. Well, I think it's good. I think that there's that's a safe haven for reaching kids in an unhealthy way. And I think that it's and a great place to create conversation where kids can feel safe to come forward as well. And and I think it's, again, there's a lack of understanding between adult and child on social media. I think kids are way more savvy on that stuff than us as adults. And again, I think it's about making sure that we do our part as parents and as adults to understand and where they're at and pay attention to that stuff. Because I think, I just think that it's the language. I mean, and then when I talk about the language, I just think it's like we can have a conversation like about this stuff. And it's, we don't have people squirming all over the place. Right, and I think that that's really changed. And there's an understanding. I think we've got past the the understanding that this stuff happens and happens a lot in society. And I think that we've got to the point of solution and creating places for people to come forward, especially our young people, right? But yet, I don't know. When we were dealing with these issues 16 years ago, it wasn't flavor of the week, right? And now there's a lot more people that are getting on board, which I think is good. And when I talk about the language, I think that we talk more about solution today and how can we be better, what can we be doing better, how do we help, how do we recognize the damage that's done, et cetera. So instead of, well, this doesn't happen here, see ya. You know what I mean? That sort of stuff.
So we have one last question, and then I'm going to call on Dr. Mark. So please.
Good afternoon, Sheldon. My colleagues and I are here from Sophie's Place Child Advocacy Center, which is down the road in Surrey. So we wanted to thank you really for coming and sharing your story. One of the things we strive to do in our work as we respond to victims of abuse is work collaboratively together. So as you mentioned, so RCMP and child protection and social workers are all working together. As we're building out that model, though, I'm curious if you had advice for us on how best to work together to keep the child and the family at the center and not get kind of distracted by all the things, as you know, that can happen around with the professionals.
Well, one of the things that I think you guys came to visit the CAC in Calgary, did you not? Yeah. Anyway, we just opened on Monday, so pretty cool. But I think that, what our goal is to really start building that piece of it, right? The interview process is one thing, so that's one thing. But when a child comes in the door and their families, is really building up that that support for as long as we need it, right? Not, here's a 10 session pass, right? It's like, and creating that around the volunteer stuff and really engaging the social services piece of it. But really building a strong victim services model around the CAC, and I think that's going to be huge. They're quite effective with the police forces across the country, victim services. So I think what we're trying to do is create one for the youth, and then help them and just stay connected with that family. And when they need, so as I think as long as somebody keeps their hand on the pulse, then we can keep them engaged, keep them involved. And I think that's the most important piece, right? I mean, I don't think it's wrong. I think a lot of times people just want to be kept engaged and kept involved in the process. And, a lot of times when they're doing that and they're giving back and they might be helping others, then You know, it might heal their own process. So that's how we plan on doing that. And good work.
Well, thank you to all of you for joining the conversation, Dr. Mark.
Well, thank you very much. Before we wrap this up, Sheldon, I just wanted to point out what a remarkable audience we have here. And I think it illustrates well how important your message is to so many of us, and how you've very effectively reached such a wide range within the audience. We have many community leaders within this room here today. I spoke earlier about our commitment as a university to engage with our community, and I'm absolutely delighted with the leadership that's here in areas of sport, social work, academia, many social services within this community, as well as the many representatives from this university. We have vice presidents, we have many faculty and staff, and some dear colleagues right here at the front from our janitorial staff. You spoke earlier about the importance of this message going to everyone. I'd especially like right now to welcome His Worship Bruce Bannman, the mayor of Abbotsford, who's never at a loss for words, so I'm going to put him on the spot and turn the microphone over.
Great. Thank you. You know, Mark said to me while I was sitting there, would you mind getting up and saying a few words? And it's, oh, great. You know, I've been known to step in the odd political cow pie every now and again, so I'm going to... I have to say today, this week actually has been a very interesting week. At lunch today at the Chamber of Commerce, I had the absolute honor and pleasure to... introduce Paul Franklin. I know a lot of you may not understand that name or know that name, but Paul Franklin was lost both of his legs in Afghanistan defending our country. And he's considered a hero. I would like to say to you that this is the second hero I've had a chance to meet today. I think if you were to ask Paul, he would say, you know what, I'll stick with losing my legs because it's probably an easier path than the path you've had to take. That courage that you have to speak up, to blaze that path where nobody had blazed before, and to give those that have been hurt, for the young lady that I heard that was speaking, I'll say I feel my heart goes out to you. And I would say that one of the things that Paul said today was when he was asked, because he went through despair. He lost his wife after he lost his legs. He came home with one leg and had to lose it from infection. And he was asked, he's incredibly positive. Like, here he is, you know, what many would consider to be just tragic, and he's not tragic at all. And he basically, when he asked, he said, well, what was my alternative? My alternative is just to plain stop living. My alternative, and when it comes, and he was talking to everybody with regards to whatever darkness, whatever addiction, whatever problem that they have where they go through those dark places in his life. And he says, yeah. He says, having no legs sucks. But what's my alternative? I would say to those of you we need to have our radar up, but we also, like you say, we have to learn to trust again as well. Because if you don't get to that point, you continue to be a victim yourself. And that's the legacy that this leaves to those that have been abused, is the damage and the brain wiring. As a chiropractor, I can tell you that your brain does change. It does change. It actually can, it physically changes. But the beautiful thing about the brain is that it can be reprogrammed and it can unchange. Those neural pathways can be rebuilt. Talk to anybody that's had a stroke and forgotten how to talk. and they learn how to talk or walk again. The brain is incredibly plastic, so whatever damage has been done to it can also be undone as well. So there is hope. And I think that's the one thing that you give people is hope. The hope that it can get better, the hope that someone's going to be there to listen, and the hope that we will understand this and be able to help those that that have been through that situation, whatever the abuse may be. The Abbotsford Police Department this year plans on focusing on domestic violence, which is also a form of bullying and abuse. It's one of the most, it too just doesn't get reported because there's a sense of shame that goes along with that. Abuse is just plain wrong in whatever form it is. And so here we are wearing pink shirt day, and I said, I asked you, is it okay to pick on those that aren't wearing pink shirts? Which is a reverse form of bullying, actually, that's going on. Though we pick on those that aren't wearing pink shirts, come on, get with the program. You're not allowed to be an individual, become part of the collective, you know? It really is part of that. We need to be more aware and reach out to those and have our antenna up for those that may be wounded. And I think sometimes all it takes is a couple of seconds and listen to your gut, your instincts. And, if you don't know where to go, ask. And I think also have those conversations with your children. We're scared to have those conversations. Oh, sex, that's a scary thing. We don't want to talk about that with our kids. Have those conversations. Have those conversations about bullying. Have those conversations and know what your kids are doing. The police department was talking about ecstasy as well, another type of hidden thing that get to know who we are as individuals, and I think we'll be a much healthier society overall.
So my antennae are up. And there may be someone in this room, maybe several folks, who want to speak with someone. As Sheldon, at a point in time in his life, as this young lady shared over here, speaking up is the first step. For university employees and staff, there's employee assistance program that you can contact. There's other services in our community that you can contact. So if something is stirring for you, please find a trusted friend or make that call to a trusted agency in our community, be it here, Chilliwack, Mission, and Student Services as well. I'm sorry, I was remiss in that. So thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Don't give me two microphones. I'll be here twice as long as... Thank you very much, Bruce, and especially thank you to you, Sheldon, for coming back for this visit and for sharing the wisdom. We didn't give you a lot of time at the podium when we invited you to receive the honorary doctorate, and we're making up for it here. We're working you pretty hard. Sheldon's going to be on our campus until early afternoon, I think, tomorrow, so there may be other opportunities for you to connect. Thank you, on behalf of the University of the Fraser Valley, thank you so much for sharing what you've learned. We're in the business of education, you're in the business of education, and we're absolutely delighted to be partnering with you on dealing with some of these very important issues. And I think we all learn from your message. Keep it simple, keep it direct. Pay close attention to what's happening around us, and for that we thank you. Now, Sheldon, you've also learned in your brief experiences here at the University of the Fraser Valley, we're absolutely shameless in promoting our university. So you did have an opportunity to wear a convocation gown. We also have for you here a jacket with the university logo prominently displayed, and we thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, before I finish, there's a man in this room who's been part of the ceremony, the celebration last spring, and he's here again today. It's the man we turn to when we're trying to connect with the extraordinarily busy Sheldon Kennedy. That's Sheldon's business partner, and a man who seems too comfortable working behind the scenes, but really deserves the recognition. He was one of the leading developers of Respect Incorporated, and a strong and effective worker in this field for many years now. So Wayne, would you come up here and allow us to recognize you as well? And with a gift. Wayne, thank you for all your contributions to this event and the many other activities. Thank you all. Stay tuned. Pay attention to what else is happening at this university. There are many, many seminars and events beyond the President's Lecture Series. We invite you to join us anytime. We are part of this community, and we're proud that you're part of this university. Thank you.